cigarettes.
Rainy streets.
Black.
Mournful.
Peter Lorre.
Shadows.
Robert Mitchum.
Lipstick.
Fate.
Bogart.
That's one, Eddie. Don't, Marlo, don't.
Don't.
It's two, Eddie. Don't shoot, it's me, Marlo.
To me, noir is about what's inside the characters. Their sense of psychosis, their claustrophobia, their desire to escape this world gone wrong that they find themselves in, particularly after World War II.
Do you know this gentleman?
No.
Did you ever see him before?
Yes, a few times.
Where?
At the patio apartments. We both live there.
You know who he is?
Yes. When I moved in a few days ago, Mr. Steele was pointed out to me by the manager. She was very proud of having a celebrity for a tenant.
Did you see Mr. Steele last night?
Yes. As I came home, I saw him going to his apartment with a girl.
That girl was Mildred Atkinson. She was murdered between 1 and 2 o'clock this morning.
In a Lonely Place is a film that isn't trying too hard to be noir, which I like. Bogart plays a struggling screenwriter who might or might not be a murderer. You never know till the end of the film. And it's his best performance, I think, in a very distinguished career.
You know, when you first walked into the police station, I said to myself, there she is, the one that's different. She's not coy or cute or corny. She's a good guy. I'm glad she's on my side. She speaks her mind and she knows what she wants.
Thank you, sir. But let me add, I also know what I don't want, and I don't want to be rushed.
These people are all trapped in these spaces, and whether it's the nightclub that they go to or the apartment house, and you can feel them trying to rip their way out of it, and they can't.
There's a cancellation on flight 16 for New York.
I'll stay with you, Dix. I promise I'll stay with you. I love you, Dix. I'll marry you. I'll go away with you. Take me.
Run away from me the first chance you get.
Don't act like this, Dix. I can't live with a maniac.
I'll never let you go.
Dix, don't. Don't. Dix, please. Don't, Dix. Please, don't.
These people can't connect even though they're in love. They can't make that final step to hold each other and hold on to each other and get through to the daylight, you know? They just can't do it. And it's the tragedy of the film. And of course, when we discover that he's not the murderer, it's too late for him and too late for them.
I lived a few weeks while you loved me. Goodbye, Dick.
In a Lonely Place could be the title of any of these pictures.
Film producers had to look beyond the shiny papers and the Book of the Month Club. And where they looked was to narratives that were produced as quickly and efficiently as the films themselves. The sort of stories that were written on typewriters and printed on yellow paper. The kind of stories that came off on your fingers as you read them. This was fiction of a different consistency. Rough, somehow.
But it was Dashiell Hammett who was the daddy of the genre. His first book, Red Harvest, was published in 1929.
Everything in there is a blueprint for the entire hard-boiled noir sort of canon that would come later on. Hammett was a Pinkerton man. He had been a detective. He had lived a life. And so what he brought was his life experience to these books, and he started something which had not been done before. He said that the system is corrupt, that if you peel back the layers, there's maggots underneath and they're writhing. And he was telling people that you're wrong about everything. Don't go to bed feeling comfortable because there's nothing to be comfortable about.
Filmmakers longed to make pictures that were as tough and sleazy as the words on Hammett's pages, but it took time for the censors to be persuaded. Here's Bogey in a Hammett story. The Maltese Falcon. It had been filmed twice before, but only this version, hatched by John Huston, captured the cheap and venal nature of its characters.
No, Effie? That's me. Now listen, precious. Miles has been shot. Yeah. Dead.
Bogart as Sam Spade is actually the definitive hard-boiled character transferred from the page to the screen. It's the most successful effort I can think of.
But please believe me, Sam, I wouldn't have told him if I thought Floyd would kill him.
If you thought he wouldn't kill Miles, you were right, Angel. Miles hadn't many brains, but he'd had too many years' experience as a detective to be caught like that by a man he was shadowing up a blind alley with his gun in his hip and his overcoat buttoned. But he'd have gone up there with you, Angel. He was just dumb enough for that.
That kind of hard-boiled world has become our reality, whether it existed or not. And it's a magnificent creation, but it is a creation.
For me, one of the most characteristic aspects of film noir, and my personal favorite part of film noir, is the innuendo, is the use of innuendo and euphemism, and the way that it talks about sex without talking about sex. One of the best examples of that, I think, is in The Big Sleep. One of the things that's important to remember about The Big Sleep is that Bogart and Bacall have had this very racy off-screen romance, quite scandalous. So they're a bit kind of, you know, maybe the Brad and Angelina of their day.
Hello.
Well.
I'm late. I'm sorry.
How are you today?
Better than last night.
Well, I can agree on that.
Well, hello, Max.
Good afternoon, Mrs. Rutledge.
Got a table for us?
Certainly, madam. This way, please.
It's the film where their famous screen chemistry really ignites. And the director, Howard Hawks, was at some pains to make sure that that screen chemistry was as kind of torrid as it could be. And there are a couple of fabulously sexy scenes between Bogart and Bacall, particularly a scene that I think even modern ears that are unaccustomed to the idioms and the slang of the 1940s won't have any trouble picking up the meaning of this particular exchange.
Well, I like you. I told you that before.
I liked hearing you say it.
Hmm.
But you didn't do much about it.
Well, neither did you.
Well, speaking of horses, I like to play them myself. But I like to see them work out a little first. See if they're front runners or come from behind. Find out what their whole card is. What makes them run.
Find out mine?
I think so.
Go ahead.
I'd say you don't like to be rated. You like to get out in front. Open up a lead, take a little breather in the back stretch, and then come home free.
You don't like to be rated yourself.
I haven't met anyone yet that could do it. Any suggestions?
Well, I can't tell till I've seen you over a distance of ground. You've got a touch of class, but I don't know how far you can go.
A lot depends on who's in the saddle. Go ahead, Marlo. I like the way you work. In case you don't know it, you're doing all right.
There's one thing I can't figure out.
What makes me run?
Uh-huh.
I think film noir's entirely for grown-ups, and it's entirely for that generation of 20-somethings, 30-somethings, who weren't necessarily in the nuclear family, who were young, free, and single, and wanted their entertainment, you know, raw, adult, mature, raunchy, and they gave it.
Film noir is a kind of cinema that we now recognise as soon as we see its stars and its shadow.
In film noir, life seems to get cheaper by the minute. It's every man and woman for themselves. And that's horrifying, but it's intoxicating too, because maybe a little part of us believes that that's how the world really is. And that's why we can't tear our eyes from the shadows. And why, more than half a century later, we keep on staring into the dark.